Good afternoon. Today we'll talk on how remote sensing data or satellite data useful in integrated agromet advisory and hazard related services. We have already discussed about different remote sensing data, its product, and some advanced application of active and passive microwave remote sensing related to agrometeorology. Now, how all those product, whether it is from optical, thermal, or microwave remote sensing, can be used in providing some societal service in the field of agriculture sector. Remote sensing data particularly useful for providing synoptic ground observation, particularly related to agromet indicator, to determine biotic and abiotic stress, its anomaly. And these can be useful for early warning or forewarning of the pest and diseases, as well as other abiotic events. Practical information, another of agromet product is mainly periodic assessment of crop condition and forecasting of phenological event. This data can also provide information on requisite partial extent and understand or analyze impact of special large scale extreme weather event like cold wave, heat wave, drought, heavy rainfall, flood, cyclone, and hailstorm. So reliable high resolution data which can be obtained from remote sensing can be used also to initialize weather prediction model, and also to assimilate into this weather prediction model for improving weather forecast. Last, this data, if archived over a long term period, that means historical archive of agromet data from satellite, can also enable digital agroclimatic database preparation for crop planning. So related to agromet advisory, IMD, India Meteorological Department, which also hosts agromet service division, which has got mandate of providing agromet advisory service. So here IMD is the nodal point and prepare district wise agromet services and issue bulletins to the various government agency. So there are these district wise, first of all, weather forecast is prepared, and this weather forecast are converted into a certain district level agromet advisories for different crops, and this is further converted into a bulletin and data which can be disseminated to the different district level authorities for implementation at the ground level by farmers. So this is how agromet advisory service scheme is being practiced operationally by India Meteorological Department. So this is a three-tier agromet advisory system where agromet field unit, there are more than 138 agromet field units are there all over India, where one agrometeorologist is placed. They use this weather forecast, and along with the other expert like entomologist, pathologist, agronomist, they prepare agromet advisory and then prepare bulletin and issue to given to the district level authorities. So first is agromet field unit who can prepare this agro advisory, the state level composite bulletin prepared by state meteorological center, then national advisory bulletins prepared by National Agromet Advisory Service Center, IMD Pune. So how this information, agromet advisory, is disseminated to the farmer? First is a mass mode. Mass mode, as I said in the first lecture, if this information on agromet available from new technology, information technology or space technology, that can bring huge national benefit. If even a portion of this information being used by the farmer in their day-to-day operation. So how you can reach to the farmers through in mass mode, that is through radio, television and print media. Then also outreach at village level, there is some IT internet, also web pages by IMD, State Level Agriculture University, ICR, and mobile phones. Nowadays, SMS alert service being developed, and some portals, Kisan portal, this Agromet advisory portal are developed in the IMD as well as ICR. So there, large number of farmers are connected with this portal to receive that MSS alert about any hazard or extreme weather event as well as related to Agromet advisory services. So almost more than 3 million farmers in 18 states are attached to this and they are receiving this kind of information. There are many Kisan call center where you can get also agriculture advisory related services. Then advisory dissemination also happened through KVKs. ICR has, or the Ministry of Agriculture has got many KVK, Krishi Vigyan Kendra. So through Krishi Vigyan Kendra also you can get information on agromet advisory. Then there are DAO, the cooperative farm unit with the line department. There also you can get the weather forecast information. Then NGO also involved in making people or farmer particularly aware about the what information generated through new technology and made available to them. So particularly with respect to satellite remote sensing, and it uses for the agromet advisory, there are various aspects where you can use remote sensing data for informed decision related to the agriculture. So soil moisture, where moisture, nutrient status or temperature, heat stress, this kind of information is very much useful for the sowing, to determine the timing of sowing, to determine that fertilizer level or fertilizer application, where you require very much information of the soil moisture and also nutrient. Then crop, where different kind of crops are grown, whether they are best suited to the existing agroclimatic condition, and also yield estimation, yield forecasting, where remote sensing data has been playing a great role. Then crop sowing and harvesting time, with the agromet data which is available from satellite remote sensing almost in the real time manner, can be used to determine timing of sowing as well as harvesting through analyzing phenological event using either LST based growing degree days or soil moisture or rainfall. All those can be useful for determining crop sowing and harvesting time. Then forest status also, you can monitor forest fire events, you can detect, and this information nowadays available through different rapid forest fire system, many developed with the satellite remote sensing data. So you can get the which area are about to take fires. Then mapping of agriculture and land resource, assessment of biotic and abiotic stress, mainly pest, disease, water, heat stress, nutrient stress, all you can map, and relevant input application to minimize the loss in the crop performance, you can also determine. Then there is some application are also there on pest disease surveillance, where particularly in early beginning of the remote sensing program, ISRO has demonstrated locust pest locust disease locust surveillance. So where remote sensing data has got a bigger role nowadays with the remote sensing data, whether it is a geostationary or polar orbiting satellite, one can also determine the spread and epidemic of the pest and disease. So we need to have different kind of all data, like particular remote sensing data, which can be used along with the weather forecast and other data, like in situ meteorological data for different kind of application, like soil suitability, irrigation scheduling, nutrient management, pest disease management. So total three component of integrated management, that is integrated pest management, integrated nutrient management, and integrated water management, can be addressed with the remote sensing data. So there are certain few value added product from satellite which has now been available or can be used for different application. First of all, as on today, particularly soil suitability, which are the area particularly in the month of June end or July first week, you can decide how these sowing, which are the area are now ready for the sowing based on the moisture condition, rainfall condition, and also you can analyze the any anomaly in the crop performance on a weekly basis from remote sensing data. One can also determine impact assessment of drought, flood, cyclone, cold wave, heat wave. You can also monitor progress of growing season, like rabi, how much area is sown under in rabi season and how they are progressing. So one can have this information for planning different kind of fertilizer or other kind of application. Then advanced application, one can monitor crop water requirement, which is very much useful for determining irrigation schedules, where to irrigate, how much to irrigate, and when to irrigate. So you can, if we use remote sensing data in irrigation scheduling or demand based irrigation scheduling, then it will surely help farmers to earn more return and bring huge benefit to the farming community. Then water deficit status one can also analyze with satellite data. Phenological forecasting, forewarning, and tracking of pest disease. So first, here you can see one picture. There, nowadays available insect vegetation index is available. So insect based CCD that can provide hourly or daily vegetation index. So based on this vegetation index for particular day or particular week, you can analyze what is anomaly from normal mean vegetation condition of the last 10 years. So anomaly signal you can capture because of it, may be because of drought, it may be because of any flood damage, or it may be because of any pest disease. So anomaly signal you can easily capture nowadays with the availability of the insect based CCD vegetation index. So this is an example where you can decide based on the vegetation index data available from the MOSDEC platform on daily basis, and also soil moisture. Soil moisture you can derive from the microwave satellite data, like passive microwave, on daily basis, like MSRE or SMOS or SMAP. So that soil moisture, if you integrate with the vegetation indices, you can derive sowing suitable area. So here, if soil moisture is greater than 0.2 on volume basis, 20% on volume basis, and NDVI is greater than 0.3 on a particular day or week, then you can say that area are suitable for the sowing. If NDVI soil moisture is greater than 0.2 or 20%, then an NDVI is less than 0.3, then you can say These are the area which are depicted here in the blue shade are potential area to be shown in the next immediate period of time. So based on this, you can decide how, okay, showing suitability, which are the area being shown and which are the area most suitable for showing, so farmer can immediately take some plan, land preparation and plan for showing their fields. Now crop progress, you can also monitor progress of crop. So rabi season with the weekly satellite data which are available also from INSAR CCD as well as it is available from MODIS data. So this kind of data can help you to derive on different dates, maybe weekly, how rabi crop area is being progressed over a period of time. Particularly rabi crop mainly in the Indo-Gangetic plain, we start from the November. So if we can monitor from November how rabi crop is area is increasing or how it is rabi crop sown area is progressing to monitor different other kind of application. So this is also one example where, okay, satellite data being used to determine cold waves, that based on the land surface temperature which you can obtain from the Kalpana VHR. So land surface temperature, based on land surface temperature, you can determine whether it is there is a cold wave or hot wave. So cold wave, okay, here you are seeing in the 2007-8 there are certain area which was, okay, experiencing cold wave, the cooler temperature, so -1 to -3 cooler temperature were there. Because of cooler temperature, as we know, wheat crop mainly require minimum temperature, lower minimum temperature, which favor the wheat yield. So if cold wave is there, then in Indo-Gangetic plain it has favored the wheat crop, and so wheat crop yield was substantially increased in 2007 and 8. But on the contrary, hot wave are there. If there is a hot wave, recently also in 2009 and 10 it was there, but at the same time it was there in the 2015 in the Indo-Gangetic plain, mainly Punjab, Haryana. During the month of January, there was temperature was rise more than, okay, 1 degree above the normal, so which has led to decline in the crop yield. So if hot wave is there, then it will lead to the decline in the wheat yield, particularly in the Indo-Gangetic plain. So LST information which is available from the satellite data has got bigger role to play in determining hot wave and cold wave and its effect on the crop performance. So similarly, satellite data has been widely used in crop yield forecasting. ISRO has developed many techniques for crop yield modeling and prediction, and as a part of long-term research and prototype development, ISRO has institutionalized a new center that is called Mahalanobis National Crop Forecast Center. Now it is a mandated agency to provide forecast of the major crops. 10 to 12 crops are there, and also this agency involved in the forecasting and crop assessment of horticultural crops. So this Mahalanobis National Crop Forecasting Center is located in IRI campus. So this particular center is does state level assessment of crop area using multi-date advanced risk data, district level assessment using single and multi-date list 3 reset and sentinel data, and also acreage and production estimate of major crops: rice, wheat, mustard, jute, cotton, sugarcane, potato, sorghum at district level, mainly major dominant growing areas. So this particular center, which use Fasal scheme or Fasal project, which is forecasting agricultural output using space, agrometeorology and land observation. So particularly in initial, before the growing season, Econometric models are used. Econometric model means trend based on the historical yield data. Econometric models are used for forecasting crop yield. Then later in the mid season of the crop, data from the remote sensing are being used to estimate crop area or crop acreage of different crops. Then in the later stage, use fine resolution data like LIS 3 and also develop some crop specific crop model based on the spectral data and use in the crop forecasting. So three time forecast is given. So first before season based on the econometric model, second forecast based on agrometeorology, third forecast based on agrometeorology as well as spectral data. So here we have done also one study where you can integrate this remote sensing data along with the weather forecasting model and the crop model. So crop model we have selected that set cereals wheat, and there was also WRF model. So based on this data, mainly to derive crop phenology and also for this LAI assimilation into a crop model. So how you can improve if you have very good weather forecast, like IMD gives CFS forecast. So that forecast is available, but that forecast information is not yet converted into a yield forecast. So this is one prototype methodology was developed to generate, to use forecast, weather forecast directly into a crop model for yield prediction at different multiple lead time. So here you can see for the point district specific or point specific, ISRO AWS station data is used for to till the time when forecast has to be issued. So here ISRO weather data used, and last 7 days before harvest weather forecast was used. Then second scenario, ISRO AWS station data plus 15 days before harvest period weather forecast was used. Then third and similarly fourth category, 45 days before forecast was issued with the WRF forecast and the control condition. Similarly, partially also NSAP data is used for the certain period, then for forecasted period weather forecast from the WRF was used. So here you can see how you can get the better improvement, because with the improving these days, 45 days even before, you are getting 0.94% accuracy, particularly for partial scale. So at different forecast, you are 95% accuracy, you are forecasting district level yield with the improvement in the weather forecast with the use of more satellite data. Here weather forecast was improved with the inclusion of the LAI, inclusion of the DEM, and also land use land cover in the WRF model. Then also side scale, it is almost 97% accuracy is there for the side scale if you use weather forecast, because instead of using only stochastic weather generator based data for forecasting yield, it may go wrong, but weather forecast, it is more representative of the location, local condition. So you can generate better forecast. Then there is another bigger program under ISRO is a National Agriculture Drought Monitoring System. In this case, ISRO is providing drought monitoring, drought bulletin on a operational basis on fortnightly scale, fortnightly time. So ISRO uses various data, NOAA-HR, OceanSat, OCM, Terra Modis, MSRE for soil moisture, then also INSAT, CCD, NDVI for crop condition, surface wetness index you can derive from the MSRE, then surface wetness also possible from the Terra Modis based on SASI index, slope angles, NSS index, and crop condition. All this data is used for drought monitoring and also issue a alert. So you can say every fortnightly or monthly drought is monitored and bulletin about moderate drought, mild drought or severe drought is prepared and given to the district level authorities for almost 13 drought prone state on operational basis. Then there is also possibility to use insect vegetation index data. The drought monitoring that operationally being done, that is mainly based on vegetation condition index or NDVI. But you can also improve this drought monitoring by developing combined drought index, both from meteorological drought index describing meteorological drought and index describing the agriculture drought. So that is combined drought index is also developed by the Space Application Center. So that is also useful for monitoring drought and estimating productivity. So any anomaly signal can be captured correct very nicely if one can use combined drought index. Similarly, for okay certain as a research case study, you can also use combined information of LST and NDVI and from okay MODIS data, and you can generate vegetation temperature condition index that can be a better indicator of the drought stress, and it is highly sensitive to the soil moisture. Here one needs to parameterize trapezoid of LST NDVI and monitor drought on a daily or 8-day basis. And it is also possible to compute drought duration directly from the this MODIS based VTCI data. And here you can see that drought duration is found to be very closely linked with the groundnut yield. So groundnut yield anomaly, any anomaly signal, anomalous performance in the groundnut crop can be detected also with the satellite derived information, and also it can be very much related with the crop moisture index. So but this is all about the drought monitoring and assessment. But what farmer needs? Farmer needs some information which is the can be directly used by him for some contingency measure or contingency planning. So we should provide drought prediction capability, or we should provide information on drought well in advance along with the possible crop loss information. So here prototype methodology one can design also. We are developing integrated drought index, where like combined drought index you can derive based on VCI, vegetation condition index, and more rainfall anomaly, as well as evaporative stress index or vegetation drought response index, vegetation DRI. They are the mainly combined drought index which integrates meteorology, remote sensing and biophysical component like land use, land cover, soil condition, soil water availability, reservoir, all. Then you can also use this regional climate model predicted weather directly into the crop model and generate certain kind of drought index, drought stress index, which can be provided. This drought stress index can be also used along with the some irrigation advisory module, soil moisture or irrigation advisory service to and this irrigation advisory can be pass on to the farmer through SMS and alert service for irrigation management. Then another event is a hailstorm. So hailstorm that occasionally occurs, but whenever hailstorm occurs, it affects large portion of area, like mainly vegetables crop like potato or some other crops. They can get completely. So one can assess hailstorm damage assessment also using the satellite at field parcel level. Damage assessment can be possible with the high resolution satellite data, where list 4, this is one picture what you can see in PFCC of list 4 of Meerut Narhara village, where hailstorm occur on the 10 October. And then, okay, after that, after post hail storm image was also acquired and asset change. So here you see all crop was in the very good condition, but after hail, vast area get affected and it is damaged totally. All leaves and stem, everything almost you can say decayed or spoiled, and so it is giving different kind of signature. So NDVI here also you can see NDVI image difference. So NDVI is very low here, okay, red you all this seeing, but here NDVI is very high. So based on NDVI differences, moderately, severely and mild affected area were into determined for different field parcel. So here you are seeing also field parcel boundary overlay for different field parcel. How many here you can see, these all pink color, that is all severely affected field parcel by hailstorm. All pink color, that shows severely affected field by hailstorm. So you can analyze hailstorm damage at field level with the high resolution satellite data. Then it is also possible to forewarn pest and disease. So forewarning of blunt plant hopper, where you can introduce along with the meteorological data. One thing what I remind you, that you cannot replace completely meteorological component. You can include complementary information from satellite data to improve the forewarning of pest and disease. So here we have also tried to develop certain kind of model for pest early warning. So we have used in addition to temperature, relative humidity, vegetation index, enhanced vegetation index, land surface wetness index and LST, land surface temperature information for MODIS on a weekly basis. And we have developed a model which can forecast during the maximum peak period of the plant hopper incidence. So you can see we have developed on 35th week, 36th week, 37th week and 38th week. This is in generally peak pest brown plant hopper incidence took place. So we can forewarn peak incidence of the brown plant hopper in rice with this kind of models, where variable is mainly found in the relative humidity in the LSWI, somewhere only relative humidity, somewhere only okay night time, okay land surface temperature. So different models we have developed for forecasting at different level, and this can be useful for pest risk zoning also in the Ludhiana. So this is a one study we have carried out in Punjab, Ludhiana. Then also it is possible to generate, as I said, all agromet data. Today meteorological data is of course available, but how many? There are hardly 500 agromet observatory. One observatory may be exist for the one district, but this one observatory may not capture the large scale partial heterogeneity in topography, climatic, land use, land cover or soil, so which influence mainly the climate or weather condition of over a particular region. So to capture all heterogeneity and to capture better the weather pattern for a local condition, you need to have a certain kind of other source of information which provided by the satellite data. So if we archive or historical data of agromet parameter, mainly LST, NDVI or you can say soil moisture or evapotranspiration, so those can be useful for agroecological zonation also. So here mainly we have used, okay, like MODIS data for historical indices, land use land cover information from satellite and digital elevation model from satellite, soil map from satellite based interpretation, then some climatic data to and some ancillary population data, crop statistic to determine agroecological zones. So you can compute many things like mean CPC rainfall or mean integrated NDVI index over different area, thermal index, heat index. So soil related parameters, soil texture, slope, depth, drainage, all integrated to derive agro-edific and agroclimatic information. Then further, you can integrate to derive agroclimatic zones, agroecological zones. This is a one case study for the Himachal Pradesh for generating or suggesting different land use land cover condition. Now we come to that was all about how we can use satellite derived information for agromet advisory or generating agroclimatic database. But apart from that, this information which is available in real time, whether it is soil moisture, wind speed, wind vector, or rainfall, all this information can also be useful for issuing early warning for natural hazard and disaster. So in India, of course, drought is the one of the most significant disaster, and large number of people get affected by drought on a long run. But at the same time, 59% of land are vulnerable to earthquake, and also 80% of coastal area vulnerable to cyclone. So these all different kind of disaster, they cause huge loss to the national economy. So there are different agencies which are involved or mandated to issue or provide warning related to different disaster. So all meteorological disaster, including drought, mandated to India Meteorological Department. The tsunami, that is the Indian National Center for Oceanic and Information Service. Then flood, it is by Central Water Commission. Earthquake, National Center for Seismology in Ministry of Earth Science. Landslide, Geological Survey of India. Avalanches, snow and avalanche studies establishment, SASE. So these are the different agencies which are mandated for issuing warning and services. So but in disaster support, in over last 10 to 15 years, there is tremendous development being taken place to with the more and more sensor available which can address different kind of disasters. So today we have got different kind of satellite which provide operationally or in real time information about meteorological and oceanic observation. There are communication satellite which can enable you to communicate any information about disaster immediately to the users. Then there is a geostationary satellite. Then for mapping, damage assessment and mapping, there are high resolution satellites are also there. Laser terrain mappers are also there. We have got also AWS, ground-based in-situ measurements are there. And there are also Doppler weather radar. All those information together used to issue warning related to flood, drought, cyclone, and other earthquake and other things. So we have this different kind of satellite like optical resource set and reset one, which can be useful for flood damage assessment, maybe also for the drought monitoring. Then this is also Kato set and reset two, and all these high resolution satellite also have capability to use for the flood discharge mapping or hydrological modeling. Ocean set, weather climatic related satellite have got potential to derive information which can be used directly in the weather prediction model or hydrological model for issuing warning. So in India, there a system is there to keep watch on weather and climate related disaster. So we have got many all meteorological station, we have got also data processing center and all those things. Space observation nowadays available from scatterometer, radiometer, radar, rain radar, atmospheric sounder, INSAT 3A Kalpana, INSAT 3D, all those meteorological sensor as well as earth orbiting, polar orbiting satellite have been generating a lot more information related to the disaster. Then Doppler weather radar being installed by the IMD at several places, they can support in issuing warning related to cyclone as well as heavy rainfall events. So in ISRO disaster management support, this provides support through National Disaster for Emergency Management, NDEM. So we provide disaster support tool, data collection, data and decision making. So various disaster being addressed in operational and real time by ISRO through disaster support center like landslide, cyclone, earthquake, forest fire and flood. So all disaster related damage assessment as well as evacuation, for evacuation, some information support and tools are provided. So first, this is an example of space-based input for cyclone monitoring, where mainly scatterometer. We have got OceanSat satellite, which has got scatterometer. Through scatterometer, wind speed and wind direction is generated, and this wind and motion vector are assimilated into a this model, particular ocean model, to generate ocean wave, all those things. And also thermal data is also used for that cyclone tracking. So using high power TIR and visible imagery, satellite geo positioning of cyclone can be done, and real time prediction of cyclone track and intensity, where hurricane research forecasting means particularly WRF kind of model can be used to track intensity of cyclone along with the assimilation of satellite measurement from the scatterometer or inset 3D observation into a this WRF model. So you see here this cyclone track every hourly, on based on hourly, it is where it is moving, cyclone is moving, where it is going to hit. So this is a latest cyclone of this Phelan cyclone in 2014, where it hit Orissa coast, and it was pop well in real time manner or well managed by the ISRO to track the cyclone with the satellite data. So here then cyclone, okay, these are the cyclone which affect lot. So you can see here there is a super cyclone, this particularly the Phelan, and then there was earlier there was also cyclone. So these two cyclone, but Phelan and this earlier was a some other cyclone. So super cyclone and Phelan cyclone. So both, you see the amount of rainfall during cyclone. Here amount of rainfall, heavy rainfall was very high. Only either localized one picture. So either here you can see the effect which is taking place because of cyclone. That once first Phelan cyclone and super cyclone, here rainfall. This is all what your blue color you are seeing, that is inundation area, flood areas. So flood area here it is okay, localized at one places, but here distributed to across whole coast in the Orissa. And damage also you can see, damage in 2013 and damage in 1990 super cyclone. Here damage is more in case of Phelan cyclone, damage to crop anomaly, food grain crop anomaly was very high, and here also crop area affected also with the Phelan cyclone is very high. So with the use of a satellite, here TRMM satellite are used to estimate heavy rainfall, every 3 hourly rainfall, then land use inundation area map based on reset, land use land cover map based on advanced sweeps. So all this information can be used to assess cyclonic damage on the crop performance, crop area affected, as well as production anomaly. Then there is a possibility to use this remote sensing data along with the certain hydrological and the weather forecasting model for flood early warning. So ISRO particularly has developed a flood early warning system particularly for the northeastern region, where 3 hourly rainfall precipitation from the WRF forecast is used in the hydrological model, which is HMS model, and river discharge is output based on this. The thresholding of river discharge, flood early warning is given. So here weather forecast, improvement on weather forecast is based on the assimilation of meteorological observation, satellite based meteorological observation, and also DEM from satellite cartosat, and also land view land curve from LIS 3. All our satellite data are used to compute discharge on daily basis and issuing warning related to the flood warning. So this is here you can see river discharge is computed for every, okay, you can say these are days, every daily river discharge is computed, and based on river discharge, thresholding of river discharge, flood warning is given. So it is started from 2013, 14, 15, 16. You see here success of this warning, it is implemented, it is very highly success, more than 50% almost all year. This early one, whatever information is given, it was on ground agreed by the flood discharge level. So this is one of the most popular flood early warning system being developed with the use of satellite data by ISRO. So for improving the agromet information or Gramin Kishi Mausam Seva advisory, also we have debated and brainstorming session was took place in IMD, where we have find out three different group where use of satellite meteorology for improving weather forecast. One working group is formed, then generation of satellite SatMet and Agromet product, then generation of value added product and information service for agriculture decision management. So these three group, they are okay, they are working till today. So I am also part of this working group 2 and 3. So there we have debated and we have prepared a plan to improve this district level agromet advisory to the block level agromet advisory service. Thank you very much.